Again, I'd like to thank the organizers of this wonderful symposium. Very impressive so far, and some of the work that Matt's done, I might support some of the things we're doing here, especially with the microvilli. And some recent discoveries by Novozymes in the use of bacillus, spore-forming bacillus, for direct-fed microbes for aquaculture applications. So a little bit different, but very much in line with the importance and the capability of these things. So the bacillus says probiotics for aquaculture or aquatic species. A number of colleagues here, Seth D'Imperio, as well as some of the professors at Virginia Tech University who have become very important in some of the work we've been doing to show the actual in-animal work. Just a perspective on aquaculture, huge production, a strong but a very challenging opportunity as well. This is not the free range, but more the controlled pond growth for the fish and the shrimp. Overall, for these controlled areas, there's been a strong increase in the about 7% increase in 1 year in the overall aquaculture industry, about 90 million tons of organisms being produced. Tilapia, for example, an increase of about 6% in the last few years for almost 5 million tons produced in Southeast Asia alone. Major issues, though, are feed costs and disease. Pangasius, or channel catfish, also an up-and-coming species, almost a million-ton increase in Vietnam alone, which is becoming a very major producer of that, about 5% increase over the full year last. And major issues is the fish meal, as well as a disease, which is a little bit hard because the shrimp is kind of encroaching on the... Shrimp is also a very important commodity. 3.7 million tons in 2015, 4% increase from the year before that. However, there is a major disease that is impacting shrimp. It's actually caused about 23% decrease from 2011. In some countries, that's a 47 to 50% decrease in shrimp. And it's because of the disease called EMS, or early mortality syndrome, that is impacting a lot of growers all through Southeast Asia, especially in Thailand. Just a view of what's happening with the shrimp aquaculture. If we look historically, we'd expect a very strong growth in the 2013 and on era, but in fact, there was a big dip. In fact, that dip is at least 23% below expectation, indicating by the blue bars, and that is a major impact on the industry. And we're not out of it yet. And it looks like the organism that's causing that is sharing its power horse, a plasmid apparently that holds the genes that are now moving into other Vibrio species. That could be a very impactful problem. So this is a real world situation we are looking to address. So our aquaculture opportunities then for direct-fed microbes in at Novozymes, we have a large collection of AFCO-approved or AFCO-positive bacillus species, intensive screening capabilities in shrimp and fish. Some of the molecular techniques have allowed us to really take a strong look at the presence and the germination of the strains, and we'll come back to look at that a little bit more in specifics. Our applications are in growth enhancement, better yield, food conversion ratio, disease control without antibiotics, and longer shelf life. Longer shelf life, especially for the product that we're providing for the feeders, using a bacillus spore-forming organism gives us at least 2 year shelf life in the real world of Thailand and Vietnam. Working with Virginia Tech has been very important for us, because their aquaculture department is very much a practical-based group. They've been working there for many, many years, but especially recently we've been looking at their extensive tank trials capability, their biometrics, a lot of electron microscopy, and now we're into the metabolomics work, which I think is going to be a very important way to go. And I'll just skim over some of the information we have for that. but I'd be happy to get more in depth with some of the work that we have done and the findings we have so far, which are fairly new. The program with Virginia Tech is about a four-year program. We're about 3.5 years into it. We're looking at tests with tilapia, pangasius, trout, and shrimp. Histological and yield enhancements with the tilapia, yield benefits with the pangasius, disease mitigation, especially with Edwardsiella ichthyolurei, or ich, with this particular catfish. Trout, which is into the salmonids now, the high-value cold water fish, a little bit tougher to deal with, but we're finding we have good avenues into that area. Physiological benefits, gut location, germination levels. We'll get into more specifics as we go. And then the Vibrio parahemolytica strain with EMS disease. Tilapia, the trial that we completed with Tech was a 14-week study. We screened a number of bacillus strains, and we see some of the best ones, especially this B1 strain, a bacillus subtilis, giving us a very strong capability. 24 tanks, 60 gallons each, two RAS systems, 312 fish. Strong DFM delivery into the gut using the qPCR and the differential DNA qPCR, which I'll show a little bit more later. And we can see and track in different sections of the gut exactly the numbers of strains that are present and the relative ratio of the germination in those areas. And what we have found in this test is looking at the biometrics performance, fillet weight, about a 1.11% increase, a very significant difference, and the pack cell volume, 9.7 and 9.5% improvement. Histological performances, again, the microvilli length, the microvilli density, I was really glad to see that. We're seeing this over and over again in many, many of these shrimp, and you'll see some of this actually right now. This is the tilapia microvilli. Again, as Matt was saying, the control versus the treated with the B1 strain, significant increase in length and density. And you can actually see in the SEM, the shag-like carpet look as you're looking down on the microvilli are looking good, but there are a number of holes and a lot less holes, a lot more density when you have the B1. And this is repeating itself in a number of other tests as well. Also, we're looking at in this particular test the more in-depth view of the microvilli for their ability to make greater neutrophils, eosinophils, leukocytes, less globular cell hyperplasia. And I'm not an expert in this, but this is what they tell me is good to see. They got very excited about it at Tech, and this is some of our earlier work. And the in addition, we've been looking at some results coming out of Plymouth University on sea bass, and they were working with a RB1 strain as well. And there was a lot more integrity of the microvilli to the point where they made a phone call and noted it in some of their papers. If you look at the control, usually has an L, for the microvilli in the sea bass, you could see, again, good lawn, but a lot of holes. And they also saw a lot of disrupted microvilli, where you see this kind of pieces coming off. And with the B1 strain, a much more smooth surface, much more dense microvilli lawn, and a lot less of the non-intact, or a lot less of the microvilli coming apart. So they have they noted this and have not seen this in other bacillus before. So at least we think there may be certain components that are important to look at as we continue on. Again, the metagenomic shift that we've seen, and this is just, a bird's eye view, but very much what Matt was saying. The when we're looking at the control, we dominate, the proteobacteria tend to dominate versus the bacillus, and the B1-treated strain, in the tilapia, you can see a much more dominance of the bacillus and a decrease in the proteobacteria. And we've gone in a lot more in depth on this, but we are convinced that these cells are changing the overall microvilli environment, at least. The pangasius work we've done, the striped catfish, or the work on an 18-week study, again, 24 tanks, 312 fish, total B1 strain has given us, again, a fillet increase of about 8.1%. If you get above 2% on a fillet increase weight, it's very economically important. Plasma protein is up. Again, microvilli length, very substantially different. And you can see that here again with the Bengasius. The control looks good, but much better, much denser and longer for the B1 strain. We did a disease study at the end of this looking at the Ichthyolurri pathogen in Bengasius. And I won't go through all the numbers here, but if you look at the control versus the B1, you'll see a lot of impact, the lesions on the liver, inflammation of the gut showing up with the control. With the probiotic, there's a lot more zeros, a lot less of the impact with that disease present. And we have the qPCR to know that disease was inoculated correctly and the strain was there in the amounts that we expected. Trout now, the salmonids, once again, the microvilli control versus the B1 strain on the on these. And again, the B1 strain for the length of the material is significantly higher. So we're thinking that may have something, trying to tell us something. And the work in trout coming up now, we're looking at the placement of our strain in the gut, a little bit more complexity than the guts of the tilapia or the Bengasius. And here we're looking at the amount of our strain that's present in different areas, the distal portion versus the proximal or mid-intestine and the pylorocecae. We have a lot of our strain present in the pyloric cecae, and the germination, which we can do by differential DNA extraction, thanks to Mobile and their kits, which are wonderful, we can find that there are, on a log scale, significantly higher amounts in the cecae versus proximal, and the distal much lower. We've looked at different strains in the gut, and there can be those that just don't make it. And these are also bacillus. This is a bacillus subtilis, another bacillus subtilis, that some of which seem to be present, but the germination rate is not so much. And this is significant when you're looking on log scale. An important part of what we're doing with Tech is to do work with Metabolon and look at the metabolomics. We have quite a bit of data from the Bengasius test on that. And what we have found is that the B1 strain makes specific compounds that are not made in the liver of the host or the fish. And some of these are released in the enterohepatic recirculation, retaken up by the host or the fish liver, and now converted into a number of species that, again, don't typically are seen. And some of them, like the taurodeoxycholic acid, are known to be beneficial for the lining of the intestine, and some of the ones we've seen for some of the valerates and others, which you can get into if we needed to, we've seen stress reduction capabilities. So it's beginning to give us a bit of a hint as to what to look for and what it is important in the metabolomics or the metabolic process of the shrimp, of the fish. Shrimp disease protection, as I mentioned, we're up against the Vibrio parahemolyticus and the EMS. This is what it looks like on a shrimp. The one on the right is a normal shrimp, even though the stomach is pretty full, and the hepatopancreas is nice and black. You can see the feed coming down the gut of the shrimp. You can see through a lot of these shrimp because they are somewhat translucent, especially the shrimp that we work with. The shrimp on the left, you can see an empty gut, apatrophied hepatopancreas, empty stomach as well, and these will die fast. And we have, as I mentioned, big losses in Thailand and Malaysia, China especially. In 2013, four provinces were down over 80%. These are pretty big impacts on the populace. And antibiotics, again, use of those substantially cut the cost, but are non-cost-effective themselves, high impact on the environment. And using these probiotics, again, some of the newer strains, we have found that screening about almost 200 of our Bacillus subtilis strains, that we can confirm two strains that are protecting the disease. Here we're looking at survival of the shrimp themselves after they've been added on the DFM, added on the feed. We can see 100% survival going down within about 104 hours down to nothing. So this is a strong impact, but we can use two strains in this case that look worthwhile in being able to protect against that disease. And actual production of these spore lots, you can see differences, but pretty much right in the 50, a little bit over 50% shrimp survival in these horrible conditions. And these conditions do take place. And in fact, the whole pond will be gone within a few days if something isn't done. So if we can put this on the feed just before it's added to the shrimp, it can make a big difference for us. One of the ways in which we're looking at visually confirming in-gut germination, we add these spores now. Remember, not lactobacillus, so the spore forming. We want to make sure they really do germinate. We've been able to put together a plasmid that has a green fluorescent protein being promoted by a promoter that only turns on when the germination is just taking place in the gut. And when we look at visually the shrimp feeding with this reporter plasmid in the bacillus, DFM bacillus that's added to the feed, we can see fluorescence fairly quickly. This is the prior to feeding, and this is a shrimp, and you can see a little bit of fluorescence in the stomach area. That's where the stomach is, believe it or not, and the gut looks pretty much not present. But when we now look 5 hours after feeding with this fluorescent bacillus subtilis strain, you can see the gut just lighting up beautifully. So we have kind of it's this gut confirmation that it really is germinating. It really is doing something for us. And we're hoping to translate that into better yield, improved value, lower disease, and long stability of our product, because as a spore, they'll last quite a bit. Some pictures I took in Vietnam and in Thailand. Questions? Thank you very much for your attention.